In this video, you will learn how to create in-text citations using MLA format. Let's start by defining in-text citations. In-text citations are the documentations within the paper itself that tell the reader specifically where the information came from. The MLA, or Modern Language Association, format is designed to minimize the distractions that a parenthetical citation might cause. The guiding principle is that just enough information is included in the text to help you find the information when you look at the Works Cited page. Let's take a look at an example. First, notice that the Works Cited page is alphabetized. This is essential because it helps readers easily find the source when they're looking at the parenthetical citation. The parenthetical citation has just the author's last name, which is all I need to find the source when I look at the Works Cited page. The parenthetical citation functions sort of like a map key that tells me where to look in the Works Cited. This principle underlies the in-text citation formatting rules that we're about to look at. The basic parenthetical citation is the author's last name only in parentheses. The first name is never included in an MLA in-text citation. The last name of the author is the first word in the Works Cited page. This is really all I need to find the source. Notice that the parenthetical citation does not include page numbers. This is because the Works Cited entry does not have page numbers. I can tell from the Works Cited entry that this is a web source that I can search, which precludes the necessity of including page numbers. Also notice the formatting of the parenthetical citation. There's a space between the end of the sentence and the parenthetical citation. There is no punctuation within the parenthetical citation, and the period is placed immediately after the parenthetical citation. When the source is a hard copy or PDF that has page numbers, you should include the page number along with the writer's last name. Notice there is nothing here except the last name and page number. There's no comma, there's no PG. Keep it clean. We can see that the Works Cited entry indicates the source is a PDF because page numbers are included here. So I have to include the page number in my parenthetical citation because it indicates that the source is not searchable, like a web page. So including page numbers is a way to help the readers locate that specific information really quickly and easily. An attributive phrase is when you mention the author's name and their credentials in the body of the paper. For more information on this, watch the Integrating Sources video. When you mention the author's name in an attributive phrase, you do not need to include a parenthetical citation. So here we have the attributive phrase, according to Susan Silby, a professor of sociology and behavioral sciences at MIT, and then the information comes. Keep in mind the guiding principle, only include as much information as we need to identify the source in the Works Cited. Since Susan Silby appears in the Works Cited, and she's already been cited as the author of the information, I do not need a parenthetical citation on top of the attributive phrase. When you mention the author's name in an attributive phrase and the source has page numbers, include only the page numbers in the parenthetical citation. So we can see here Micheline Maynard has been named as the author of the information in the sentence. Her name appears in the Works Cited page. I have page numbers in my Works Cited entry, which tells me that the writer was working with a PDF. So I have to include the page numbers in my parenthetical citation. Sometimes the person we mention in the attributive phrase is not the author of the source. So we indicate this by including QTD in, which stands for quoted in, before the author name in the parenthetical citation. It's fair to ask why we would even want to name someone else in the attributive phrase. Well, the best reason to do that is because that person is the expert. If the writer of the source you're reading includes an expert opinion, you can and should highlight that expertise in your own paper. As Tony Kajewski, president of the American Society of Agricultural and Business Engineers, observes, that sounds like somebody who knows what he's talking about. But he didn't write the source. This information came from Lee Allen's work. So to indicate that, to make it really clear to readers, I have to write QTD in Allen. Also, please notice that it's only necessary to include the QTD in if the attributive phrase names the speaker as someone other than the author. It is not necessary for all quotations. Also notice the formatting of the parenthetical citation. The Q and the I are lowercase. There's a period after the D. There's no other punctuation within the parenthetical citation. Sometimes we find a great source but no author is attributed. When this happens, whatever comes first in the works cited entry is what you put in the parenthetical citation. Usually, this is going to be the title of an article or web page. So we can see here the parenthetical citation has put the phrase global in parentheses. The quotation marks tell me this is the title of an article or a web page. Then when I look at the works cited, I see that the first thing there in this entry is the global. Notice that it's not necessary to include the because it's understood. And when we're alphabetizing our works cited entries, the is not included as the in the alphabetizing. Global would be the word we would alphabetize by. The parenthetical citation, remember, is like a key that helps readers find the source. We read from left to right. So the key to the source needs to be the leftmost content. This is why we cite it by the title of the article rather than the publisher, like the International Crisis Group. It's not that we're highlighting the creator, it's that we're helping the reader find the information by putting whatever comes first in the works cited entry in our parenthetical citation. Also keep in mind the other guiding principle or the related guiding principle. Include only as much information as we need to identify the source and the work cited. Notice the difference between the parenthetical and the work cited. The writer has included only the word global because this is all readers need to find the source in the work cited. Quotation marks are included in the parenthetical because that's how it's formatted in the work cited. Titles of articles are always placed in quotation marks, and that doesn't change just because you're using a parenthetical citation. So it is the rule that you take the main keywords from your article title and put only those in parentheses. You do not need to include the entire article title. That becomes too distracting. Sometimes we find more than one source written by the same person, which can be great because that means maybe this person happens to be an expert in the topic. When this happens, include keywords from the title along with the author's last name in the parenthetical citation. This is going to help us distinguish between the two different sources. So pay attention here to the parenthetical citation. Kelly is the author. And the article that this is from is the one that's called The Problem is That Free College Isn't Free. Notice the difference again between the parenthetical and the work cited. The writer has included only the problem after Kelly because this is all readers need to find the source in the work cited. Kelly's other article is called The Cost. Once again, notice the formatting of the parenthetical citation. There's a space between the comma and the opening quotation mark. The title is capitalized and placed in quotation marks. there is no punctuation before the closing quotation mark. Also notice that the second article by this author looks like it's not even there. But this is another MLA rule. Anytime you have more than one source written by the same person, all subsequent works cited entries use three hyphens with spaces between them instead of repeating the name. If you're using Noodle Tools and you use that feature to export your works cited, this will happen automatically. Sometimes you have a source that was written by two people. For sources with two authors, include both last names in the parenthetical citation. Both names also appear in the works cited page. This might seem to contradict the guiding principle. We could say, well, all I really need to find it is Bousset. But I like to think of it from the point of view of the second author. Wouldn't you want your name mentioned if you co-wrote something? Notice the formatting of the parenthetical citation. There's no comma after the first name. Also notice how the works cited entry formats the names. The first author's name is written last name first. The second author's name is written first name first. When you have three or more authors, it's a slightly different rule again. Some sources, especially those in academic journals, have three or more authors, and listing all of those authors just becomes too much for the reader. Also, in those situations, usually the first author is the lead author. So when this happens, you include the author's last name and the phrase et al, which means and others in Latin. So you can see in this parenthetical citation, the source is Logal et al, and we've got a page number. When I look at the work cited, it's Logal Christine et al and others. So those match up. Notice the formatting of the parenthetical citation. There are no commas. A period is placed after all, and that's it. Page numbers are included because the work cited entry tells us that the source is a PDF. When you notice that the same information appears in more than one of your sources, you need to cite all of them. Don't go crazy here. This doesn't mean you need to scour the internet searching for all the sources that might have this information. It's just that you need to do your due diligence as the writer. If you happen to see the same statistic mentioned in more than one place, you need to say that you got it from all of those places. In some ways, this also helps build your credibility because it shows that, hey, look, this fact has been cross-referenced somewhere else. When this happens, you use a semicolon to separate the source information. Occasionally, you may find it necessary to directly quote a passage that exceeds four typed lines. When this happens, you need to create a block quote, which has these formatting rules. First, it's double-spaced, just like the rest of the paper. It's indented half an inch from the left margin of the body of the paper. The parenthetical citation is placed after the period. This is the only time that the parenthetical citation is placed after the period, and it's not put in quotation marks. And I really want to emphasize the next point. You should only be using block quotes if you have a really good reason for quoting such a long passage. Most of the time, you can and should cut down on the quote by choosing only the most important words and phrases to cite and paraphrasing the rest. In fact, when I was looking through my student papers, I couldn't find any block quotes because I spend so much time emphasizing the importance of choosing just the most important words and phrases, and I do expect my students to spend time doing that. One of the things that can help you with this is omitting from the middle. If you want to omit something from the middle of a passage, you indicate the omission by using an ellipsis, which is the name for the dot dot dot, or the three periods with spaces between them. It is not necessary to use an ellipsis when omitting from the beginning or end of a passage, as it is understood that the quotation was taken from a larger context. This covers the most common citation scenarios. If you need additional information, you can consult the MLA Handbook 8th edition. The Purdue OWL website is another great resource for MLA citation information. And here's the link, although it might just be easier to Google Purdue OWL MLA format.